Let me tell you guys about these apples that I just bought. I went to the grocery store. I was buying apples. I normally do, like, sit there and stand there for a while. I know it's boring. James, I'll listen to these apples. Okay.
Am I Seinfeld?
What's the deal?
What's the deal with apples?
I purchased these apples. I put them in a bag. I got home, and I'm like, on my way home, I'm doing that thing where I hadn't had dinner, yeah, and I'm starving, so I just grab an apple, and I start eating it. I take a bite of said apple, and I look at the apple. The apple tasted like cinnamon.
What?
Yes. It tasted like pumpkin spice and cinnamon.
Okay.
And Grapple, which is like this company that makes apples that taste like grapes, they had a fall promotion where their apples that they manufacture from the trees, I guess growing is also another word for
genetically
that.
Genetically modified.
Did you intend to buy those?
I wasn't really looking.
It's sort of a haze of buying
apples. You accidentally bought, like, not actually apples.
But, like, they're the coolest apples I've ever had.
Not to make fun of Noah, but do you just walk to the store like in a haze?
Honestly, I was so exhausted. It was, like, really late, and I was like, you know.
Bought some super basic pumpkin spice apples.
I did, and they're delicious. They're so good. They taste like cinnamon and pumpkin spice.
Hey, Noah, do you know what time it is?
What time is it, Steven?
It is time to talk about death and taxes.
That's actually not how it goes.
Yeah.
Welcome to Let's Talk About Death and Taxes. On this show, we talk about the two things that are inevitable in life, as Ben Franklin once said. Death and taxes. This is an estate planning advice show. So, like, if you plan on dying, then you should die with an estate plan.
Ben should know.
He did die.
He did die. Yeah.
Wasn't he also, like...
He was very old.
He was old, wasn't he, like, racist? Or no, he was, like, progressive.
No, he was fairly progressive.
He was pretty progressive.
When he was, he had prolific amounts of, like, extramarital relations.
Yeah. he was very outspoken. He was a fan of older women.
Gotcha. And bifocals.
Like his fetish was like
really
like
is that real
older women yeah
that's
no,
hilarious
he like wrote about it
his yeah. wife was very very tolerant
yeah
or maybe just didn't give a crap.
Well, also like it was all, he was in France
oh so it's no
what happens
there,
in France doesn't count
it's like zip codes weren't even invented yet
gotcha
area codes
I guess they're still extending like letters over ships
yeah
oh god that'd be
you
so
be about
tough
6 months behind you could really get the jump on some bad news
like people still sent letters via pigeon back then yeah.
Could you imagine trying to date somebody by writing letters and sending them via pigeon like that'd be the
no.
worst.
Unrelatedly Warren Harding if you ever follow the thing he had this extramarital affair when he was president and he and his mistress exchanged letters in the 20s and the 20s they are the most vulgar things that
I've
have ever been written
read those.
I would blush.
Yeah, they got published.
Yeah.
Oh, they're horrifying.
Yes.
They're so embarrassing.
You're like, oh
they're
my
so
God.
They're so embarrassing. Yes. And you look at a picture of Warren Harding and you're just like, you perv. You perv.
You're just like, how is this most boring person the most boring time?
Like that little smile he has in all of his portraits really takes on a new meaning. When you know,
yes.
when you know what's going on in his head.
Yeah, you're like, oh. And John Oliver on his show, he got the wax thing of Warren Harding on when they in whack music was selling old presidents.
Oh yeah?
Yeah.
Oh,
but God. Because he is clearly the horniest president that we've ever had. Maybe ever. Maybe ever will have.
Bill
Clinton.
Steven.
Maybe Bill.
Oh man, JFK? That saxophone.
Oh, it's true. Okay, fine. I'm like amending it. There's probably at least
look,
five.
Guys,
I don't know
guys,
about
guys,
presidents.
There's so many horny presidents.
Let's get on. Here we go.
Let's keep going.
Can you guys, on that note, can you guys explain your, introduce yourselves and give your some of your credentials here?
I'm Steven Schreiber. I am somehow an attorney at law.
and an expert in horny presidents.
Yes. I have lots of things that interest me, but mostly estate law, sometimes reading about the gross actions of dead people. You really
it's so much weirder when you phrase it like that. Like you're reading history books. It's normal to read history books. When you say it like that, it sounds gross.
History is kind of horrifying.
Well, yeah, man. At least it's sterile.
There's almost no, well, maybe not for him, but like there's no like time period I would want to really go back to beyond like 1990. There's really nothing in time that I'm like, I really want to go back there as a black person. So history is really safe place to study dead people being trapped.
Yeah, that's fair.
Sweet.
But anyway.
And I'm James Champlin. I am also an attorney at law.
Fantastic. Cool. These guys have big fancy law degrees from big name schools, and I do not I barely know anything about the legal system other than, like, I probably shouldn't do anything bad.
Don't break laws.
Yeah, that's pretty much...
Try not to steal. Yeah.
That is my understanding of the law. So
make a good faith effort not to break too many laws.
So this show is kind of... I get explained things to me because I'm dumb. I'm sorry. Okay, I'm a little tired, guys. It's also the afternoon, so...
Well, it's also your fifth beer.
Yeah, you know? God. I'm such a lightweight. After about two, like, I'm...
It's not. It's spot. His first.
It's his first. Fine.
Yes, we didn't clarify work. That.
We need to clarify. Yeah.
That is
we
a
are
joke.
Not al- we are not currently drunk.
Yes.
No.
Yet.
Yeah.
The shots come. So after every question, we do a shot. Oh, yeah. Could you imagine? That'd be a show.
That'd be terrible. I listen to some podcasts where they do a shot. There's one I listen to that's really good. It's about a book series I read. And every time they make a Harry Potter reference, they take a shot.
A couple
that's
podcasts.
Great.
And they'll take, like, a couple shots an episode.
I forgot what podcast it was. Like a power hour where, like, every minute you take a shot of beer.
Yeah.
Except then I just feel like vomiting.
Not, do that.
Like,
it's the not hard part of the power
I don't even
hour
get drunk. I just feel sick.
You have to stay committed to it. Yeah. It's more
air,
volume.
The air between, I don't know.
You have to make sure you're not drinking beer that's too cold.
Yeah.
You have to have warmer beer.
You have to stay on every minute. How mundane and boring it is would really get me more than that.
I used to listen to a podcast called Crit Juice, and they would play Dungeons & Dragons, but every single time somebody rolled a 20, they would all take a shot. And, like, people roll 20s fairly frequently if they roll a lot.
Well, it's a 1 in 20 chance.
Exactly.
Yeah.
How many, 5% of the time they roll a
20. It's 20-sided dice, right?
Yeah, it's 20-sided
dice. Okay, yeah. So 1 in 20.
Exactly, 5%. And so by the end of the episode, the beginnings of the episodes are all really great because, like, they're all really smart improv comedians, but, like, the ends are just like, and then I hit him in the face.
Like, really God, good. I wish court were like that sometimes. I wish it was like a 2-day trial. By the end, everyone's a sloppy. I'm like, I don't know.
Well, have you not seen the video? Oh, there's videos out there.
Oh,
like,
I've seen drunk lawyers.
They've released, like, court surveillance footage of lawyers who showed up drunk for court. And they're like, I'm sorry, judge. And they, like, drop their papers. And
that's awesome.
Yeah.
Having a rough day. And they're just like, how did you get to court today?
Yeah.
Like, I drove.
Subaru.
I don't recommend it. So I'm coming to it should be part of the ritual. It's like, if a man's going to go to jail for the rest of his life, he should be allowed to really drink during that trial.
But not his lawyer.
His lawyer should probably not. Maybe the judge. Like, at some point, as long as the jury has a handle on it.
They make court
the judge
just starts
calling random. He's like, objection. It's like, I don't give a fuck. Whatever. It's like, sustained. I don't care.
Our first question comes from avo.com. I cannot locate an original codicil for my mom's will and only have the original will. Is the copy of the codicil valid? I only have the copy and not the original. I'm also the executor of the will.
I got to answer this question.
Yay.
There's a clean answer, kind of.
Can you define what a codicil is?
Okay. So if people have a will, a document that says, I leave all my stuff to this, to the whatever, and they have an executor and stuff like that. A codicil is like an add-on to your will, where you either add extra provisions onto it or you change a provision on the other will.
It's like a little amendum.
Yeah, exactly. Addendum.
So if I decided I no longer wanted to disinherit my brother, I could do a codicil.
You could bring him back in.
To bring him back in.
Gotcha. And then bring another one to kick him out.
Is there a limit?
Yeah,
oh my God, that'd be really
funny. You can do as many codicils as you want.
Does that, like, 5 codicils? You're just constantly reading.
Once a year, I file a new codicil. So, you know, if I die in an even numbered year, Chris is lucking out. But if it's an odd numbered year, too bad for Chris.
You're gonna create an incentive.
And
at
your
some
poor
point
wife to, like, has to, like, bring, like, a binder clip of thing, like a giant.
Yeah,
the
no, that's my goal. That's
it's
my goal.
Like,
yeah.
Here it is.
I want to look. Assuming that I've passed before her, I want to give her something to take her mind off of her incredible. What's the word
grief.
Here? Not remorse. Grief. Yeah. Grief.
I shouldn't have killed him.
It may go from grief to remorse, but I'd be okay with that.
Yeah. But the codicil is like an add-on. It has to get signed with the same formalities as a real will.
Okay.
With 2 witnesses and a notary in most states.
And so she can't find the original, but she has a copy of it.
Okay. So under Georgia law, and I can always test because I would practice here, but you're allowed to present a copy. Okay. Maybe for that. If you don't have the original, there's a presumption that it's been destroyed. And if that's the case, the will would just stand on its own. She might have decided to get rid of the codicil, but if you can present the copy to the court along with a sworn statement saying that they did not actually intend to destroy it, it was just lost by a mistake or accident, then the court can consider that and whether to admit that into probate as well.
Okay.
And usually if all the heirs agree or all the interested parties to the will and stuff agree to admit this thing, and it was a copy, but it was a real document. Mom just, or whoever it was, just happened to keep terrible track of papers. Then you'll admit that to probate. But if there's any evidence, if anyone objects to any evidence that they did mean to destroy the original, then they'll exclude that copy.
Gotcha.
On the upside, the will, there's still a will that would be standing, but just not the codicil. But okay. I would present the copy and also present the court an affidavit stating that we believe this is what they intended to do. And then it would be up for our court to determine the intent of the deceased person.
Cool. So you can still submit the copy as long as nobody like objects to it and has an incentive to be like, that's not correct. Like,
yeah. Okay. If there's an objection, I would even say there's a better than even chance it gets thrown out.
Gotcha. Okay.
You lose coin flips on that more often than not.
I think that was one of the most straightforward answers.
I can see why Steven was so excited. Yeah.
it's like, oh God, I can finally give like a relatively quick
finally,
answer.
Finally, this is an easy one. Yeah.
Cool. Copy of a will, if you don't have the original will, is a copy of a will good enough?
Same deal. Same as the codicil. Yeah, you have to have evidence.
Like the presumption is that no, it's not good.
Yeah.
Because so if I have a will, right, I can make copies and give it to people so they know what's in it if I want to. But ultimately, all I have to do to revoke the will is destroy the original.
Exactly.
So just because somebody has a copy that either I gave to them or they made without my consent, if I've destroyed the original, that's what counts.
But if everyone knows I'm a flake and I lose things all the time,
okay.
And I told them, hey, this is my actual will, and everyone agrees that's my will, they'll admit the copy to probate.
Yeah,
cool. So copies are okay as long as nobody objects.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. As long as there's no evidence that as long as the evidence tends to support that it was their intent and it just happened to be a copy.
Sweet.
Yeah.
All right. Let's move on. This one should be, again, a little bit fun. Not as fun as the Titanic description, but I did enjoy this as well. The year is 1985. Noah and James have not yet been born.
To be fair, I am a young child.
How do you feel about that, Steven?
I feel triggered and attacked.
Teenager, also
someone creeping towards middle age.
Don't throw out your hip over it.
Teenager Marty McFly lives at home with his failure siblings, his alcoholic mom Lorraine, and his cowardly dad George, who is frequently bullied by macho jerk boss Biff. Marty has a weird, unexplained connection to local mad scientist Doc Brown, who has just made a huge breakthrough in the time machine he's building out of a 1982 DeLorean. After a run-in with Libyan terrorists that Doc previously stole plutonium from in order to power his time machine, Doc gets gunned down as he and Marty are testing said time machine. In order to escape, Marty travels back to 1955, where he meets his teenage parents. Marty must make his parents fall in love so that he doesn't get erased from the timeline. His goal is to make it back to the future.
And weirdly not hook up with his mom.
Yes, because she does. She's like gunning for it. What a strange. I guess in the 80s, that was like a normal, fun thing to put on the screen. Like, look at these hijinks. Nowadays, that'd be like, ugh. Like,
now they like make fun of it in shows. So like Futurama did a spoof on that.
Really?
They did.
Where it's like super weird.
Fry goes back in time and accidentally becomes his own grandfather.
I love that episode. I love Futurama. It's great. Ah, the dog episode gets me.
It makes me cry even when I think about it.
I skip that one on my rewatches because I can't take it.
Yeah. It's a lot. Yeah. This is a good boy.
I got a couple questions.
Yeah.
In Back to the Future 3, here we go. That's comes later. Doc Brown got the money to build his time machine from inheriting his family fortune. Could I put a line in my last will and testament that demands my heirs only use my money to attempt to invent a time machine?
That's okay.
You would want to do it through a trust, though.
Yeah. You would want to do it through a trust, but the actual request seems, I mean, that might be evidence that you're not of sound mind, so you might want to really double down on your evidence that you're not out of
mind. So maybe reference. So all right. So they would say if he believes that time machines were real. Obviously, he was not of sound mind when he executed this. So what I would do is I would find everything I could that has to do with actual scientific research regarding the possibility of time travel, and I would incorporate that into my will by reference.
And it depends on who does it. If Elon Musk has that in his will, I'd be like, sure, that makes sense.
That plays. If the narrative, that's on brand.
Gotcha.
So I mean, we've talked about this a little bit before because, like, part of this show is me asking you guys about crazy last will and testaments that I can do. So I think the context is a little bit different. But for people who have seen this for the first time, so basically, if you use the will as the mechanism to kind of force your heirs to do certain things, that they can basically petition the court and say, hey, he was not of sound mind, this is an unreasonable request, and I should get all the stuff anyway.
So
right?
In a will, just generally, so all wills go before courts. I think that's true in every state. And it is subject to potential challenges to certain bequests or gifts in it. I mean, for various reasons.
You okay?
It's going back in my throat. Okay. That a bequest can be void as against public policy. Like, I can't – there's certain requests that I can't have – bequests I can't have in my will. Like, I can't require someone to marry someone of – even a particular person. It's just, like, a problem. Or – certain bequests are no longer relevant. Like, when people left slaves in their will, we can't do that anymore. Certain bequests are completely irrelevant. You can't limit people's rights, and you can't do things that generally public policy wouldn't support. Like, I can't say you have to – you can get your bequest, but your real bequest is when you knock over the rob the liquor store.
Gotcha. You can't do that.
Yeah. I leave you my sawed-off shotgun.
For the purpose of
knocking over this liquor store.
That's going to be a no-go.
Or you can't say, I leave you $30,000 if you marry a Catholic girl.
Yes.
Okay.
Can't do that.
Yikes.
So
I can say that. Because I'm Catholic.
So, but now you're saying a trust, though, is not subject to those same things, right?
It's a lesser limit.
Lesser limit.
There are certain things you still can't do, but it gives broader discretion to do many things. Like, for example, set up your time machine company. Honestly, I would set up a time machine company before you die because that's crazy.
Yeah, why not?
And honestly, if I'm going to die tomorrow in a time machine, I might want to spend that to go back in time to before.
Well, it's not that I think that they're going to make a time machine that successfully works. It's more like I want to torture them with, like, having to spend my money. Like,
find a better way to torture them.
That's your intent. That's bad.
Unless you're shifting
into a bad intent. You should have a genuine love of the time machine.
Okay.
And if the evidence starts supporting that, then it makes more sense.
That they could potentially finish my work on said time machine.
Yes.
But
if it's also, I want them to be annoying, or I want they could only get my inheritance in $1 bills.
Yeah, that's not gonna happen.
Ooh, that's fun.
That's really
nickels.
Yeah.
So what happens if you leave your kids the money to build a time machine?
Yeah.
They build a time machine.
Yeah.
They go to the future.
Yeah.
They get advanced medication.
They come back. They save me.
And they saved me, and then I no longer die.
Yeah. Do they have the money to build the time machine?
Was the bequest valid?
Was there a bequest?
Steven, answer concisely.
Yes, Steven, use your logic.
And the biggest question I have is, why was Marty McFly friends with an old man?
It's unexplained. Yeah, that's the weirdest part about that.
Look, if... he's a local eccentric.
Yeah.
Marty is a young man with a sense of adventure.
Yep.
The doc is the kind of guy who knows how to get plutonium from some Libyans.
Yeah.
He's the kind of guy who's fun.
That's true.
You know? That sounds so creepy.
Don't make this sexual. It's not sexual.
It's not even sexual.
It's just adventure.
It's just so weird.
I know. It's adventure.
So I went on the wiki, which is called the Futurism Wiki or something. Like, they have a fan wiki.
Like the Back to the Futurism?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay.
And they say that... Marty, exactly what you said, he seeks out the eccentric old man that the town is talking about. And Doc Brown, because Marty's such a cool, hip, young teen, Marty says that
Doc Brown... they made it bad.
They did. But they say that because Marty called Doc cool, that's why he wanted to hang out with Marty McFly, because he wanted the acceptance of the youth at the time. So, anyway, little fun fact
okay.
there.
That's fine.
I got a second question here.
Oh, my God. Yeah. That's bonkers. I'm an old man, and I'm the... Actually, there's a decent chance that one day I will be the eccentric old person, and nonetheless, I should not have teenage friends. That is weird.
It's only weird if you make it weird, Steven.
In Back to the Future 3, Doc and Marty travel back to the Old West. There's a pivotal scene where Doc sends a letter from 1985 that is received by Marty in 1885. Doc sends this letter, okay? The letter is received in 1985 by Marty because it's via the mechanism of the Western Union.
Okay.
So this got me thinking, if Doc files a will / trust in the 1800s and then comes back to his time and dies, and maybe not his time, but maybe like a time in the future, right? If he dies 200 or 300 years later after he's filed his will in the 1800s, like, is that will valid?
Oh God, I have so many questions now.
Yeah.
Like, what if I die now and then I don't know. Can I undo my death? What if I somehow changed my history and then I'm just... I'm already dead. My will's been probated, but I'm back here.
How do you change your history if you're already dead?
I don't know.
Yeah. No, I think this goes back to earlier when your kids make the time machine.
The records may not have changed.
The records may not. Here's the thing. I think the short answer to this is
the
law is not equipped to deal with this situation.
Okay. So hold on a minute. Let's just say somebody.
I need to become the law firm of time change.
Let's get out of the realm.
I need to start the research now.
Let's get out of the realm of the supernatural. Let's get out of the realm of time travel. If there's a 300-year-old will that has my name, Noah Chrysler, hi, on 2020, I file a will. 300 years from now, I die, right? And it's wild. Let's assume that we haven't invented like crazy technology. But 300 years from now, everybody else dies normal around 100, right?
Sure.
Everybody's kicking the bucket. I just happen to live for 300 years.
It's going to raise some questions.
Okay.
But assuming certain things have not happened, that will would be valid.
It will still say valid.
As long as you didn't get married. Or what else is in there? I know if you get married, it'll invalidate it.
It typically invalidates it. If you have kids, it'll force them in.
Okay. Yep.
I don't know.
Okay.
There's really not much that would change.
Primarily, it's marriage that would invalidate it, but beyond
as long as you physically maintain, your bigger danger is literally that paper decaying.
Exactly. So that's my question is, like, what institutions have to survive in order for something like that to be possible?
I guess the courthouse
has to survive.
The probate court. I was thinking like the American common law system, right? Like if America goes down, like...
Oh, but then probably not worth it. You might as well just shut it all down.
Yeah, no, I mean, if we've descended into anarchy, what are you even packing
up? Yeah, besides your weapons collection, or it's like the 300 years, you're just like in some sort of Mad Max.
I leave to my children my car that I've covered in spikes.
God, I feel like I should start getting ready for this.
And I leave them 300 gallons of clean drinking water to be split equally.
And rations.
Rations. Yeah.
Don't drink it off.
I thought this would be more interesting. So I guess the answer is just yes, as long as society hasn't fallen
apart.
Yeah,
there's no time limit on a will.
It doesn't expire. No. Incidentally, there's certain things that do expire, but not that.
Sweet.
Powers of attorney would be rendered useless.
Yeah, because everybody else
is dead. Since our agents are dead.
Yeah. That's true. Okay, cool.
Hopefully we'll be able to heal people Star Trek style, so we won't need health directives.
That'd be nice. Like, with like a replicator
that
or whatever.
Thing that they wave over people when they do surgery. It's like, that seems unbelievable, and yet we've all chosen to believe this is a thing for this plot device.
It's the future, man.
Everything's possible in the future.
Everything's possible.
Last question. If you woke up in 1985, you're transported back.
Well, you two wouldn't be there, but I woke up in 1985.
Well, no, like current
state. Yeah, we're zapped back to 1985.
At this age.
What do you do? That's my question. It's not an estate planning question. It's just a fun one.
And then, like, do I later get zapped back to the present?
No, you don't. You're trapped.
There's a lot of things I really wish I would have. Okay, 1985. What was a fad in 1985? What do I need to get a jump on? I need to get a jump on the LA gear or the hammer pants or really stock up on some stuff that are going to become real fads down the line.
I would, as soon as I get there, I would write down a list of everything I could remember being a fad from, like, the 80s, 90s, 1000s.
And try to capitalize on that.
And just try to capitalize
it. Stay on the curve.
I just get a job. I guess.
Yeah.
You know, how to eat.
What would you do? What would you do in 1985?
Can you imagine how cheap school would have been?
I couldn't be a lawyer.
Yeah. Could be a lawyer.
I'd have to go about. I have to go to law school.
Yeah, you'd have
to go
to law school.
Imagine how cheap it'd be.
Actually, no, because I wouldn't have a college degree.
Oh.
So I'd have to go to college again.
How cheap that then, how cheap tuition would be.
It would cost like $8.
Yeah.
You wouldn't use your knowledge of the, you would go to law school.
That's depressing to me, James. Like that you're like,
well, because you need a college degree.
Yeah, but you know the future now. You can just invest in like Apple. And
I wouldn't be a lawyer. I wouldn't be a lawyer. I would be a consultant.
Yeah, I would have been, I would have worked, I would have seen like what Apple is up to. That Mac is.
I would get a job in marketing. I would go and I would file patents and trademarks on everything.
Oh, that's a great idea.
Everything.
Get a real jump on the internet.
That's a fantastic
idea. Like, I own Twitter. Yeah. Don't worry.
And I would be like really quiet about it. So I would like just copyright, like just do it.
Oh, that's amazing.
And then not say anything. So then, you know, down the road and then, you know, wait till these companies start to use it. And then, you know, just make sure I follow the law.
You'd have to start using it too, though, to keep it.
But you know what? That would honestly, that would probably alter the timeline so much because people try to
that's
do
a
things.
Good point.
And then, like, then
it.
You're in like Calvin Ball, like, they're in this
There's
weird
no
dystopian.
Rules.
It's the 80s. There are no rules.
I would
president.
Well, okay, on a practical level, I would go to a lot of concerts. Because think about how many bands from like the 60s and 70s and even 80s are like classic, like awesome live acts.
All of them haven't broken up yet.
Right.
Well, the Eagles have broken up, but the other.
But you could go see those. Those
I'd go see
a lot of concerts.
I'd probably run into my parents and I'd be like, hey guys.
I would avoid that.
Really?
Yeah. Why would
I was already
alive. Oh, because then I might not be around. You're right. Yeah, I don't want to mess with that.
What if your mom falls in love with you? We don't want that.
Yeah, yikes. Oh, God. Okay.
Hey, don't be mean to your mom.
Let's change the topic.
No, let's dig in.
Why have we talked so much about my mother during this episode?
Well, you're the one who brought it up, Noah. You're the one who brought it up.
No, I just thought it'd be funny to screw with them and be like, I know everything about you.
I'd probably go meet my parents
while
they're still
young. No, but like as a bit, as a joke.
Oh, God. As a joke. I'm going to go ask out my mom.
Not ask out. I never said that, James.
I'm pretty sure that's what you said.
That is not what I said.
We'll have to look at the footage.
Play back the tape.
We'll look at the footage, but I'm pretty sure you said that.
I think it'd be cool to hang out with your parents as like, you know, like I don't think I'd be friends with my
parents.
I don't think they'd want to hang out with me.
Really depressing. Yeah. Like a 2-year-old and a 3-year-old and a 1-year-old.
Yeah, my parents were fun.
Yeah. I would have hit them near their low point of like sleep deprivation.
I mean, my parents are super fun, but I just think that like they would have been into different things and I would like they were into like rock shows.
Well, but like
and,
if you showed up
cool
and you're
stuff.
Like, my name's Noah and I'm your son from the future, they're just like, we can't have kids.
Yeah, that would be it. That would be like,
yeah, that doesn't
huh?
work. They would, and they certainly wouldn't be like, oh, God, I really like the name Noah. Now we can't use it.
Yeah, this crazy homeless guy. Just...
nut job.
All right, we've got off the rails a little
bit. I would already be alive. I would have, God, the concerts I would have gone to would be, actually,
would you go?
Would be really good back then.
Actually, yeah, no, the hip-hop scene would be great.
God. I can you imagine somebody's like first time listening to the show is this episode?
I would like I would.
Does a part of you want to go back and like rewrite a book?
That'd be cool. Oh, yo, Harry Potter. Harry Potter's
like,
my idea.
I would tell Tupac to not go to Vegas.
Yes.
Ever.
There's like this word to the wise.
Yeah.
Don't go to Vegas.
Don't go to Vegas. Yeah.
You want to? Don't do it.
I would try to make friends with like a bunch of like up and coming struggling comedians like Ellen DeGeneres. Like I'll be Ellen DeGeneres' best friend.
Pick a better one. She's canceled.
I know. Now she's canceled. I don't know any other comedians. I'm young.
Like Seinfeld's still young. Or
Seinfeld.
Or Roseanne's canceled. But other people who became famous.
Pick a comedian.
Roseanne's like, fuck. The bad.
No. Cool. Or, you know, just like hang out, like find Bill Gates. I guess he was probably doing
something. Steve Jobs. You could probably find Steve Jobs.
I mean,
he plays
be Steve Jobs' best friend.
You know
also,
where...
tell Steve Jobs to really get that paper out of cancer treated.
Yeah,
well,
like,
but you know,
chemo.
You know where things are going. So you could get a job that pays decently well,
yeah.
And then you just invest
well in stuff.
Because you can think about it. Your act of small investments, like
don't go
find like, you know, 12-year-old Bill Gates and be like, here's $2,000 to build computers, bud. Don't do that.
12-year-old Bill Gates.
Like,
his dad was rich. His, there's
yeah.
a major
well,
law
you know what I'm
Gates.
Saying,
his
right?
His dad's the Gates.
No,
like
don't, you know, yeah. we don't want to, like, over-influence, but, like, little incremental, like,
yeah.
I'm going to buy shares.
Get some Apple
right,
stock,
right.
Get some
that may
stock.
Not cause a paradox.
That's or exactly right.
Don't buy IBM stock. Ditch that thing, IBM
Why?
Stock. IBM was kind of had a rough late 80s.
Buy
well,
AOL,
yeah, but then
but you
like
buy AOL,
quadruple,
and then
right?
you know when to sell.
Oh, yeah, AOL. Yeah. Buy up to AOL.
Oh, my God, I would do so well.
AOL was a fucking rocket before AOL was able to buy, like, Time Warner.
Amazon? You could just buy Amazon and then just, like, have an army later.
Keep an eye on Jeff Bezos.
Yeah,
Tesla.
Keep an eye on Bezos.
PayPal.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Sweet.
We need a payment platform for the internet. Which
I'm going to copyright one-click purchase.
Shopping cart. The word shop. Online shopping cart. All right. Here we go. Reining it back in. Mm-hmm. How do I go about helping my son collect benefits left to him by his deceased father? This is a really long one. Strap on in. Here we go. My son is incarcerated. He recently...
That is a ride. Sorry, go ahead.
He recently informed me that his daddy had a life insurance policy that named our boys as beneficiaries, and they would receive their monies on their father's 50th birthday, whether he was still living or passed. He died in 2015 and would have turned 50 in July 2020. I have no knowledge of this other than what my son has relayed to me. I suppose I need any/all advice, direction. And as I'm sure these days I'm struggling financially and unable to afford an attorney. Okay, cool. Let me set the scene here. I'm a mom.
Please use the word separated. Daddy one more time.
Yeah. If you don't say daddy, I'm not listening.
I said it with like a big snap to daddy. His daddy. Yeah. I'm a mom. My son is incarcerated. I believe I'm split. I believe it's a split household. I haven't seen daddy in quite a while.
Probably not.
Son says, hey, 5 years ago, do you remember how daddy died? And I say, sure. He tells me, oh, dad said that I had a bunch of stuff left to me. But I don't know how to go about getting it, and I'm in jail, so I can't do it. I'm sorry, prison? I don't know.
Probably incarcerated. Depends how long. It was longer than a couple of years. Prison. Probably prison.
He's in prison. He can't do anything. I'm mom. I don't have enough money for an attorney. Do I do anything? Can I do anything? What do I do?
You could do – okay, so if they're in Georgia, you could do a few things. I mean, not a lot of things are free, but you can file – if they haven't set up an estate yet, they can file the probate paperwork in the county where he last resided. Courts will grant fee waivers for people who have or are unable to pay the initial filing fees, and that, it'll give them the power to – well, I'm not sure. She mentioned her son. I don't know how many other children the dude had before he passed, but if she gets the consent of all the children, she can have a fairly uncontested granting of the power to gather his assets.
Cool.
Having said that, once she gets the power, though, it's a little bit of a treasure hunt.
Mm-hmm.
And that's
where's
where,
the life insurance policy? Where's the banks that his money was in?
But would that be a part of the estate?
It depends. So life insurance policy with no beneficiaries go to the estate. Mm-hmm. Sometimes people, surprisingly, maybe not so surprising, a good chunk of life insurance policies have no beneficiary. So that becomes part of the estate. Or the beneficiary on it died or something is just left vacant. But really, she's probably going to go around looking for the bank accounts and all other stuff. I don't know. So... this is where personal knowledge is helpful because if you can go back and get his bank account, what I usually recommend is people go and find the decedent's bank accounts. Mm-hmm. Because a bank accounts, you can pull up all those old statements and the bank would produce them for you. And
but
it will show,
is the bank just going to be like, oh, yeah, let's have this?
Oh, you have to be random- the court appointed. You have to be the court appointed person.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Okay. So you get the probate, you file the probate thing. You're the, what is that person
you
called?
Get the paper, the
called probably the administrator. He had no will, so administrator. Okay. But you would get his old bank statements, and this is the freest way to do it.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And go back to his bank statements and look through the lines. And if he had life insurance, it probably drafted out every month the payment. Then you're going to want to have to find that, and sometimes it will just have the insurance company. And then you go to the insurance company
and say, hey,
and make a claim for the – and let them know. They typically only communicate with the beneficiary, but they'll often confirm the presence of a policy there.
Yeah. And this is something, too, where a lot of people that are incarcerated will choose a trusted friend or family member and do a power of attorney while they're incarcerated.
He hopefully trusts his mom.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, so, I mean, for the situation, yes. Mom would talk to son about getting a power of attorney done. And a lot of jails and prisons actually have mechanisms where they can kind of help people get that done.
Yep. Yeah, they do.
Because it is because very common.
Can you explain what power of attorney is?
Oh, power of attorney.
I feel stupid.
Essentially,
I've heard this term so many times.
That's the point of the show.
It's too late to ask, but I'm going to ask. What is power? Explain it like I'm an idiot,
please.
Let me
explain agency law for you.
Yeah, so basically.
One of my favorite professors at law school, she wrote the legal guide about agency law.
Okay.
And it's very interesting and yet very boring. But
a power of attorney is a document where I can give somebody else the right to act as my attorney in fact.
Yes.
Oh, okay.
So I give that person the right to represent my interests
as
in
if,
a million different transactions.
Yeah. So gotcha. They can act as if they were me or as if they were that right. person.
So like when Verizon says that I can't access my phone plan because it's on my dad's business plan, if my dad gave me power of attorney, could I potentially access
for the business?
Phone?
Potentially. Okay. He would have to give you the power to right. interact on behalf of his. So he would grant that power as owner of his business, I guess.
Gotcha. Right. I'm sorry.
Also,
that's
your
just
dad
one,
is and, nailing it because he's getting a tax. Are, he's oh, he's yeah. writing off his taxes anyway. Oh, yeah.
sorry. That's just one infuriating thing. They will not let me have access to my phone plan. Also, like, he does pay for part of it. I do send him a check. He's great. Okay, sorry. I feel like a child.
All my parents pay for my cell phone bill yeah. literally until my late 20s.
Perfect. I don't feel as
my
bad.
My mom was like, I'm too lazy to I didn't feel like changing the plan, so I'm just letting it roll.
I didn't pay for my own until law school.
Yeah. And honestly, it was so cheap back then because I had a flip phone that I could have, like, thrown it across the room, drove my car over it. It'd be fine.
Yes.
Gotcha. Anyway, so power of attorney lets someone yeah. acts as you basically be.
So you have
your
to trust
attorney,
them though, because
right?
they.
But you yeah. can delineate what it's for, right? So you can do one for finances, you can do one for healthcare.
Yeah,
gotcha. And there's different things.
And most of the time, this run like the finance one,
right?
Okay. For the most part, some states, Georgia does not have a power of attorney for healthcare. We have a document called a health. Advanced directive for healthcare. Yeah. It gets very confusing very quickly right. according to different state laws, but the power of attorney for this purpose, let's say it's about just the money stuff.
Yeah. So and you can do also, I mean, you can also delineate exactly what powers you're giving in that agreement. Yeah. So you can be cautious. But powers of attorney they can be very scary because a typical power of attorney gives somebody else a lot of power.
By default, yeah.
It's something that people have used to defraud family members. So wow. it's something that if you're talking about doing a power of attorney, you have to really, really run it by an attorney.
Yeah,
and a neutral attorney, not an attorney that your buddy knows.
Yeah,
you have run to run it by a neutral attorney.
Gosh. But generally, whoever you appoint as your attorney in fact agent, they have fiduciary obligations to make sure that they are using anything that they do, they have to do it on your behalf and not yeah. for themselves.
Not to screw you over.
Yeah, it's not like. A power attorney is not like a please take all my money agreement. It
gotcha.
Is a
it's meant
use
to help
my
you.
Money
it's use my money for
my
me.
Interest as gotcha. If you are me.
That is very cool. So if we were to make this woman a to-do list, number one would be get power attorney,
probably.
Power of attorney.
I think
for
that would make
son.
Things much easier.
I'll gotcha. Start with that. And, okay. and there's yeah. an estate you would need to get the probate stuff started.
Yeah. Okay. So get the power of attorney, then go to the probate court, and
if she has the assent of all the heirs, so she want to gather up all the
gotcha.
Heirs. If he's the only kid, then that's
heirs.
Easy. If the dude was married to someone else, then
well,
it
yeah,
gets
we,
more
well,
complicated.
We know there's two kids because the it was like one of her son
brother,
and his
yeah.
brother. So
yeah, I'm not sure he was yeah. married. It gets but she'll either want to do right. the probate or get someone to do the probate.
Okay. So power of attorney. Permission of heirs, do the probate, find the bank account, find the life insurance, distribute the funds.
Life insurance, yeah, exactly.
And I haven't looked to do
this.
This
is not an easy endeavor.
Although I haven't looked at Georgia for this specifically, but I know that most states maintain a database where you can look for unclaimed.
Yes,
life
after
assets.
A certain period of time, yeah. the Georgia Secretary of State has a search you can do. I know this recently because I had a really old bank account and the bank told me and the bank was like, we've submitted to Secretary of State. I was like, for $40? It's like, yes, you have to now claim it. It's yep. it's like, really?
Wow.
I don't want that money that yeah. badly to fill out the
yeah,
paperwork.
Yeah.
But they will do that. And same for insurance policies. After enough time passes after someone dies, most states it will go to the state fund literally for unclaimed until someone eventually claims it.
Right.
Cool.
So that might, if he died long enough ago, 5 years might be enough in whatever state they're in, but it might eventually yeah. pop up. So you might want to pull up. And most states have an online search. You might want to pull up the online search for unclaimed funds and see what's yeah. in there.
Sweet.
That'd be the fastest way, actually. Let's start with that.
See if there's anything there. Yeah, before you go on a goose chase.
That's the freest solution.
But if you go there and you look and nothing does show up, it doesn't mean it doesn't exist. It just means it hasn't gone to state yet.
Yeah.
Gotcha. Cool. With that, we're going to move on to our next topic here. Great. Cool. I recently had
can
you guys.
I,
yes.
Okay, I'm
bathroom.
Oh, no.
Oh, you're going to have. Oh, can I have one too? I'll take the High Life in there. Or honestly, I'd prefer the Blue Moon, but I know we're running out of those. So,
High Life.
It's the champagne of... Yeah, I'll take that.
Okay. I didn't realize we were running short. I grabbed it.
So I originally didn't like beer at all, and so I got like a 30 of Miller High Life when I was in college, and I committed to drinking one every day until I enjoyed beer.
Why did you choose that?
I just had one. Beer you didn't enjoy?
Well, no, I mean, Miller High Life is like... It's,
well, I get picking like a light... kind of watery beer.
The first time I drank
cheap, I went for cheap, but I didn't want to go cheap. I didn't want to go like Miller. Like
the first time I got
Miller High Life.
The first time I drank a bunch of beer.
Regular Miller Light is better than Miller High Life.
I love Miller High Life. It's a champagne of beers. Get out of here, James.
I remember the first time I got drunk on beer. I was like a penny pitcher night with Coors Light pitchers, and it was very gross.
I love Coors Light.
I have a very soft spot in my heart for Coors Light because it almost tastes like nothing.
Wait. None of these are sponsors.
God damn it! Cut it all out.
Yeah, bleep it all out.
Cut it out.
Good stuff. I recently had you guys watch The Social Dilemma because I thought it was interesting, and I thought there would be lots of cool, fun, legal stuff in there to talk about. If you guys haven't seen it, I wrote a quick summary. It's not quick at all. It's a pretty long summary. You cut me off when it gets awful and depressing, okay? Here we go. The Social Dilemma is a documentary on Netflix about how social media is basically like ruining the foundations of our society. You know, democracy is kind of just like really trying to chug along, and social media is really just like throwing a wrench in the works here. The film depicts how social media algorithms are basically eroding the foundations of our society. Everyone has their own set of facts that they're given, and these facts are as a result of rabbit holes that are designed to constantly feed people content that resonates with their worldview or is purposefully against their worldview so that they have like strong emotional reactions to their social media news feeds.
It's like we're permanently in litigation.
Okay.
Opposing sides.
Gotcha.
And we're just all choosing to believe our only what helps our case.
One side. This leads to political polarization, as I'm sure you know you guys have seen, which is not great. A tiny number of predominantly left-leaning white men in Silicon Valley control the primary systems that feed information to the entire world. In the course of human history, this is the first time that this has ever happened at this scale. Thousands of people now regulate the information systems that give information to billions of people. Depression and suicide is on the rise, especially in young people. This is tied to social pressures of using social media. These apps are built to be addictive, and they heavily rely on dopaminergic feedback loops. This is so that advertisers can bid to get their ads in front of consumers. A lot of experts think that we're headed towards a civil war. This is already happening in places like Myanmar.
You could call it Burma and insult them. No. I mean, the British called it Burma.
But anyway, basically this idea that like you get a custom feed of information that doesn't matter. We're not concerned with the truth. We're concerned with what's going to make you use our app the longest.
Yes, it made me stop my social media.
So I said this when you said you want me to watch this. I said, if I hate this, I'm going to bill you for it. Noah, do you have your wallet?
I do have my wallet, but I don't carry cash, James.
You don't carry cash?
No.
I'm going to need you to get your Venmo app open.
Yeah, I will. I'm going to need you to Venmo me $5. I'll do it.
And I gave you a discount. No, I didn't like it. It was horrifying.
It's horrifying.
But it's
all,
the truth,
it's
man.
All stuff that I knew.
Plug your Venmo in right now. I'll pay you right now.
Okay. Oh, you just gave me your...
I gave you my power of attorney over my phone.
I would just literally start sending dollars out to random people.
Just my contacts.
I'll just be like, "Hey, mom, I'm sending." My mom doesn't use Venmo, but I'd be like, "Hey, or hey, Noah's
right, so
ex-girlfriend.
We'll put a five.
Here's a dollar. Remember Noah?
Oh my god!
So we're gonna do $5. Or can I make it five? Make it more? What do you think, Steven?
Five's fair.
500. 500. And in the memo, I'm gonna put. What's it for?
Pain and suffering.
For ruining,
ruining my
your Tuesday night.
Guys, also, this is a multimedia show, so if you want to go ahead and follow me on Venmo, you can see this post. It is, in fact, real.
No, mine are all.
I didn't know until just this moment that you could be followed on Venmo.
I think you can.
My Venmo's private.
Oh, my Venmo
imagine being
is so
Venmo famous.
Private.
The only person I pay on Venmo is my therapist, and I refuse to have people see my Venmo
okay,
payment.
Let's
boom.
See.
For ruining Tuesday night. Fantastic, James.
Which, to be fair to the people who produced that, it was very well done.
It was
okay,
amazing.
Okay, there's parts that I disagree with. Okay. The acted part.
Okay, received.
Part,
thank you.
No problem.
All the parts with the
I'm gonna,
actors.
By the way, no offense. I'm sorry, I mean not to cut you off. I'm going to get that back sometime during the course of the show in some like weird legal scheme. It'll be great.
You're going to good luck. Out that and get like $5
game on.
Value.
Can we sue him for $5 in some way? I don't know. We'll
I could.
You just, agreed to give it to him.
I know, but like now we're going to file some.
And it's recorded.
I hilariously would make you pay me more money to
maybe I'll save up and do it someday.
What are you going to sue me for damages? Get out of here.
No, we'll find some trumped up claim. Maybe you bumped into me in the hall and now I get $5 in some way.
I will fight you tooth and nail.
It would be a really fun publicity stunt to do in the office. Are you kidding me?
Look, you just got to find something that you can do that I'm willing to give you $5 for and don't make it weird.
No, no. See, I don't like that. That makes me the...
make it weird.
That's an important caveat.
It's only weird if you let it be weird.
Let's get back to the task at hand.
It's only weird if he makes it weird.
What do you guys think about dystopian social media hell?
The acting goes terrible. I could deal without the entire storylines of the people.
With like the paid actors.
Okay, it was a little on the nose.
Okay, not so much...
Having said that,
not so much with the documentary in particular, but the takeaways and like the societal implications of what the...
Oh, it's terrible. It was a real downer.
It's ruining everything.
And it was also a downer that someone let their child be called Tristan and not just Tristan like a normal person. But anyway.
I like Tristan. He seems like a really good guy.
Is he the guy with the dreadlocks? He's the
No.
Tristan was the guy. He had the beard. He did the...
He's the guy. He looks like Thomas Middleditch's character from Silicon Valley with a beard.
He had that thing.
Yes. Okay. Yeah.
He's
exactly
the one that
keep
filming him while he's prepping for speeches, and he's like, whew.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. And he's like, yeah. And he's.
And I really like him.
I have very mixed feelings towards him as a person. One, that he's my age, and it's his period of like
lecturing. He's just accomplished.
Yes.
How does it feel? How does it feel that he's running a for-profit company that basically is designed to like raise awareness of like this?
Well, and he's also testified in front of Congress.
To be fair, that's not that big a deal.
I'd say it's a deal.
It's a deal.
I've
encountered a lot of dummies who've testified to Congress.
Well, yeah.
But don't you think it's funny? He's profiting fighting.
That was really hard. Okay.
Wait, is it a for profit?
If you know me and you've testified to Congress, I'm not insulting you.
I have no idea.
Is it a not for profit?
I watched it and I was like, I'm done. And then I didn't look anything else up.
Yeah, maybe it's not a for profit. I don't mean to.
I instantly went on. I instantly Googled him to see how much of social media he was because I was just curious, ironically.
But I think your point would still remain. Even if it was a non profit, you know, he's still supporting himself through
fighting this monster,
fighting
that
this
he's
issue
built.
And
that he
that's
created.
Pretty cool. Yeah.
The
he's the guy. Yeah, I mean, you just watched it too. I mean, he wrote that thing at what is it, Google, that he wrote the thing?
Oh, the outing letter
I remember when that happened. Like, I can remember that, hearing whispers of like something big happening in tech, and then just poof.
Yeah,
gone. But I don't know. I liked it. I liked the guy with the dreads.
He's my favorite. He has a really good book.
And just like he talks with his hands, but he doesn't move his upper arm.
He doesn't move his elbows.
He only does this.
I forgot his name. Like,
but
Jared,
he makes it work. Something like Jared. Yeah. And it works.
He's fantastic. Because I remember seeing him. I was like, oh, I've read your book. It's really good.
You read that man's book? I'm sorry. I viscerally disliked him. I agreed with everything he said, and I still hated him, which is a very rare.
That's unfortunate. I love him.
When I saw him, I didn't think he looked like that. It was very odd because I've only heard his voice and read his words.
Oh, he's got
his
voice is amazing.
To see him. Yeah. I was like, oh, that's what you look like?
Well, I mean,
it
you never...
Maybe I'm a bad person.
Were those dreadlocks?
They were definitely dreadlocks.
Look, I think it's
there
safe
were a
to
lot
not...
of things happening.
What do you think he smells
okay
like?
With.
I feel like he smells awful, but I agree with everything that he said. I'm sorry, that's awful.
I'm not comfortable
mix
that.
That. I'm sorry, that's really not cool.
He must be a hippie.
I feel bad.
He smells like a hippie.
I'm embarrassed. Okay.
Cut that out, Oscar.
Oscar, please.
Oscar, I've never met you. I've seen your video. You did good work. Just cut that out.
No, but...
So we're not allowed to comment on smell.
But the social
we're not allowed to make fun of people's appearance unless they're a douchebag.
Okay.
No,
sounds good.
He's really smart.
And he's a good person.
He is a good person.
Although he's the only one who wasn't tainted by having worked at one of those companies.
Right.
And then
where
pivoting
that's true
around.
Where all these people are like, I made millions of dollars unleashing this monster. Someone needs to fix this monster.
And also, would it have been that much effort to find one person of color who was worked at? Is it just not to be found? Is there not a black person that we could get?
Yeah, that's real.
Yeah, great question. Yeah.
Silicon Valley, man. That's
anyway.
There was
a woman.
Well, there was one person of color.
Yes.
The guy from Facebook who did all the, like, growth strategy.
Yes.
But did he actually appear in the documentary, or was that just, like, file footage?
I'm not sure.
I can't remember.
There was one woman they had.
But
so
still,
that
it was so
white man. It was even whiter male than the Republican Party.
Whitest
male gathering and that's not a I had thing, ever seen.
But I think what remains to be determined
and they're making these weird decisions that impact all of this.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Whether that's an issue with the documentary or what I think more the more likely
although
issue.
Although they're just documenting what happened.
It's with the, But no, it was.
It's very depressing. I didn't even get through parts. Where I was like,
that
no
part for me was people. It's like they all like, this is a huge problem. We really need to fix this. We've got to fix this. It's
like,
awful.
If only someone could do something about it.
There were never apologies. There's never, I don't feel like I felt like any of them actually expressed remorse over what they did. They're like, well, we just didn't know. And it's like, what do you mean you didn't know? You specifically set out.
Yeah, this was your job
was your
title.
Literal
to hack the human
to
psychology using an algorithm that's only going to get better the more it works and gets more. And you want to give AI rights.
I do.
And I think you're wrong. And this is it.
I think you're wrong.
This is it.
I agree because I watched Battlestar Galactica that
every
one
other,
time.
Look, every other episode, badly. I'm going to attack Noah's thoughts on giving AI rights.
This is
the moment for this
let's
show.
Let's all take a note of all of Noah's thoughts and feelings and then make a note
and
to
slowly erode
Noah
them.
So at some point, we get an episode where he cries.
Oh, wow. Okay. Yeah. This show stopped being fun and now turned into my personal hell. No,
Oscar, if he cries, don't cut it out.
Keep it in.
Leave it in.
That's real. That will really appeal to somebody. People will probably be like, that asshole's making that guy cry.
Yep.
I absolutely love that.
Yeah, definitely.
I'm more likely to cry than anyone else.
That's really funny.
But no.
But okay, so I have a bunch more questions. Okay. From a legal perspective, why have these companies been allowed to go unregulated?
Oh, they're rich.
Because they're rich. Okay. Yes. Because they're rich, they found loopholes in laws, and they hired so many lobbyists.
Oh, and they write the if there's a vagary, the legal system was not prepared for this particular thing.
Right.
And it's never prepared. It's every time there's an innovation, the law always catches up because law people who write laws are old.
And all of
people.
This is like super, super recent in legal terms.
Oh yeah, oh yeah. It's like
last 10 years. Yeah.
You probably don't remember it. I remember a life before social media. I think I literally graduated college before I got my first smartphone.
I remember that, Al.
I remember.
I got my first smartphone. After college.
I might have already got my master's degree. I remember Facebook being created when I was in college and being like really excited because my campus was like one of the first ones to get it. And like, this was great. And you could literally pull up on Facebook how you fit into the entire network.
Wait, hold on. You were in the beta? You were in like the...
Amherst was pretty recent because it was
in
proximity to Boston, I think, a lot. So it just made
that's
across the state.
That's crazy
so
to me.
It was very... I think we were like school at like 10 or 12 or something.
When you first used Facebook, did you like think like, oh my God, someday this
it
is
going
to be...
Like, it felt extremely modern.
Yeah.
Like, oh my God, look
at
us.
It was one of those like, I can't believe no one's ever done this before.
Yeah.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Especially when... So you used to have an EDU account. Yep. It was just students.
It was exclusive.
So it was like, I can't believe this hasn't happened. Like, this is just for, I got mine before I started my freshman year. So it was like a whole new thing. I was like, I'm off to college and I'm getting a Facebook.
Whoa. Yes.
And I'm going to add all these fun friends.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. We didn't realize that they were slowly buying us.
That eventually they were going to destroy the world.
Yeah.
Yes. If I had known then, I would have really stuck with MySpace.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, if MySpace won, it would be the same
I remember being upset when they were like, we're going to expand Facebook to anybody, not just current
I
don't
know. I remember being
students.
Very upset.
I remember thinking, like, this is dumb. This is going to ruin
the
Facebook.
Platform. And it did, ultimately.
Guess
it
what?
Did.
It did. It,
they
it
really should have kept it out.
When my mom sent me a friend request, I was like, oh, okay.
I can remember.
My mom is fantastic.
I'm calling Dr. Freud. Let's talk about this.
Be on Facebook, and my mom is great because you'll probably see it because it will get posted on my page.
Oh, my mom's
and
not
your
on
mom,
Facebook.
Please like and share.
Yeah. So I can remember.
Hit the share button, whatever that is on the bottom part.
I remember.
Get
I
it
think,
into your network.
I can't remember. I think my dad got one because he had an educational email address because he was a teacher.
Oh.
And I remember being home and him being like, Jim, I made a Facebook account. I was like, great.
When did you stop going by gym?
I go by that sometimes. Oh, gosh.
You have Jim, Jimmy, Jimbo. And James.
Yeah, I've gone by everything except for Jimbo. There's like one person out there who is routinely. In the past, there are two people who have called me Jimbo routinely, and it's because they know that I hate it. So like, Mark.
Remember that $5 I sent to Jim?
Mark and Joey, you know who you are. You know I hate that. But he said, look, I made this Facebook account. Yeah. I was like, that's really cool. And he's like, I'd like to add you as a friend. And I was like, that's okay. And he's like, I promise I won't, intrude.
Yeah, cramping style.
And I was
style.
Like, cool. So I accepted the friend request. And he sat there in front of me on his laptop, and he scrolled through every single tagged photo of me.
What the hell?
And asked me who I was with. Like, oh, who's that?
Oh,
who's that?
My God.
Like, who's that?
Like, he's curious.
Who's that lady?
I went unfriend. Yeah. Oh, Dad, I'm so sorry.
Oh, God. I got hacked. And he'd be like, Jim, your eyes look weird in this one.
Wait. So he was earnestly so going through your feed.
Yeah, he wanted to get to know. It was very sweet, but yeah. It was just like, this is going to go poorly for other people.
It seems way more tedious than anything. It's like, oh, God, can we wrap this?
But this was back in the day. I didn't have, a ton of tagged photos. So.
Gotcha. Oh, yeah. I was in college. Like, my worst times, the times I would not want documented were not documented on the internet.
Oh, I'm so glad middle school me didn't have a
webcam.
Like a college where we had a party and you're like, everyone leave your digital cameras
guys,
at the door.
What?
You had to take a picture of someone digital. You had to bring out your own, your phones didn't have a
camera. I actually had a friend in college who would bring a Polaroid to camera.
That's pretty sick.
To parties. Yeah. He would bring a Polaroid to parties.
You can still get a Polaroid.
And he would take pictures of people, and if it was a real good embarrassing Polaroid, he would just send it to them.
Hilarious.
Like, that here's your picture.
Yeah, that's making a comeback. That's making a huge comeback.
Macro Center lights on Polaroid film was awesome.
It's the only it's like $1.50 a shot.
Yeah.
The only thing I'll say.
You better keep it reserved for a good shot.
I've been trying to make it as a YouTuber for about 10 years now, and 14-year-old Noah had some bad ideas.
Oh, God. YouTube existed when you were 14.
What? I think
YouTube was created in 2004, 2005.
Yeah.
Because I remember it. With being creative, that's crazy. Videos on the internet.
That's crazy,
that's bonkers. That's a cool
niche website.
Next question.
And now it's everywhere.
Have you guys seen the videos of Mark Zuckerberg trying to explain to Congress how Facebook works? And they're supposed to be. He's explaining to the regulatory body that's pretty much making legislation, controlling the giant beast monster that he's created, and they don't even understand. Like, there's literally
My favorite was the guy in the documentary who's well, I'm glad I'm going to be dead soon because this stuff scares me and I don't understand it.
Both of us grabbed our foreheads at the same time when you said Mark Zuckerberg. I was like, oh, God.
Yeah.
No, but there's a video where
talking about Chuck. Okay, if Chuck Grassley or that was Senator John Tester, who was fantastic from Montana, who lost a finger in a meat grinding or meat cutting thing.
If there's ever a way to lose a finger.
That's it.
He's awesome as a person. He's really blunt. He got up to Montana multiple times.
But he's a cowboy.
Yeah, he's a cowboy. I think he's great. But if he's I don't know what the fuck is happening here. I'm just a senator. Honestly, what expertise do we expect senators to have?
My favorite
on every single topic.
My favorite moment.
It's
from,
very complicated.
But what it comes down to is if he's trying to explain to the senators what's going on and they, as the governing body, cannot understand it, why have we not made some kind of task force or regulatory agency so we can establish the expertise and regulate?
Oh, yeah. I don't think senators don't know anything. I expect, with oil drilling, we have a mining agency. With food, we have a food agency.
With phone. We were talking about earlier, TV.
Right. TV, the FCC. And that's later in my question here.
They need to get really into that and have, build a bureaucracy that can, regulate this.
Right.
And we should probably get rid of those algorithms. I think honestly, what would be probably generally way better. If
I think you should have to opt in.
Yeah.
My next question here is relevant to that.
I would pay for Facebook if it got me out of some of this crap.
If my favorite thing from the Mark Zuckerberg thing is when the senator is like, they think they have this gotcha moment, and they're like, Mark, if you do not get paid by your users, right? If nobody has a subscription, then how does Facebook make money? And Mark Zuckerberg looked at them and he's like, is this a trick question? And it's they think they've got him. And he goes, we sell ads. And the woman's just like, Oh.
So, yeah, we
you've got me.
Yeah, I was like, someone asked me a question, like, how do you make money? It's like, I sell estate plans.
Right.
Is this a trick? Yeah, I would literally be confused if a senator asked me something like that. It's like, how do you make money? It's like, I write things down? Like, I don't understand. But yeah, but as a Facebook, it's more jarring that me as a person who runs Facebook ads is actually Facebook's customer and not me as a person
as
who
a
looks
consumer.
At Facebook.
Exactly. Right. Terrifying. If you were to create a, like, electronic internet bill of rights, like, you're going to amend the Constitution. You guys get your pens. You're the founding fathers of the Internet Bill of Rights.
I'm not
going
to lie. That's pretty deep into my list of changes. But above this one.
I would, first off, I would say, why aren't we taking care of this with statute? Why are we amending the Constitution?
Oh, we definitely need the Constitution.
Okay.
Then we should definitely ban AI.
Yeah.
Be like, the Constitution
not just
bans
give
artificial
no rights. Ban them.
It's like, fake people do not get rights.
Ever.
Okay, wow. Ever. That is...
It is very close to
hot take.
That is not what I thought you said. We're going
to
say...
No, no, no. You're not saying that fake humans have to work for... No, it's not saying that. You're just saying fake humans are not
going to get rights. Okay, in the context of this conversation,
yeah.
If you are tasked...
I'll just be a dick on that.
No, you're totally good. If you are tasked with protecting...
the rest of the show. If we're tasked with protecting these rights.
If you are tasked with protecting the average American on the internet from these big, massive companies from being like mindless drone consumers of advertisements,
yeah.
What do you do as a regulatory body?
I would make sure people knew what data they had.
Yeah.
And I would probably give people a chance to opt out or... Realistically, we should treat it more like a utility. People should just pay to get access to Facebook or Twitter.
I think you should have to opt in. I think it should be, if you want to use Facebook, you can either pay or you can opt into our advertising.
Do you think that artificial intelligence should play a role in
advertising?
No. Do you think it should be illegal to include artificial intelligence in advertising?
My issue is not with the advertising. It's with, like, the biggest thing for me was the notification cycle.
Gotcha.
Right? Like, for me, I don't care that much if, you know, Facebook is keeping track of, like, what ads I click on so that they can give me more ads like that, because that's a way for them to get more without making the service cost money.
Theoretically, it's supposed to help you.
But, like, what I don't like is when, you know, all these – there's, like, cross-platform sharing, right? So if I'm not logged into Facebook on my home computer because I just don't really use my Facebook. And if I'm Googling something on my home computer and then I get onto my – phone, right, and I jump on Facebook.
Shouldn't be able to track you.
I'm going to see ads for stuff that I've been Googling.
Sure.
And that is awful, right?
Yeah. Yes.
Like, I don't like that cross-platform sharing where it's just, you know, creating this image of me. You know, like, I don't have a problem with a company saying, we're going to take our own data that we're generating based on your use, and we're going to tailor ads to you. Like, that doesn't bother me quite so much.
So, like, if it was just device-specific, you'd be fine.
The dopaminergic, like, cycle, however that's said, like, where they're trying to make it addictive on purpose, I think is terrible.
I think it's one thing to target ads, but nothing to actually target the content.
Yeah.
I think
target
we should,
and change content
we should
based
limit,
on
we should, I think opinions. I think we should control access.
And the kids. We should.
The kids, yeah.
Okay, another thing I would also
do. And that's something that's beyond my expertise level. Like, get doctors involved.
Yeah. But I would verify identity. I mean, I think it's weird that we have these check marks when people are celebrities and not just check marks when we can verify the person's a real person.
Yeah.
Like, we should literally, there could literally be like a process where it's like an ID check or some other.
Mm-hmm. Tinder actually does that.
You have to do it for Venmo, too.
Yeah.
So, like, if you're a Venmo, if they think it might be fraudulent, you have to mail them or you have to send them a selfie with your ID.
But be able to verify that and verify dates of birth using official documents and give, if for a teenager, I mean, you give like a stripped down version of it or something, but you need to like not subject children to the same exposure to content as adults do. And honestly, adults probably need to get a stripped down version.
But I guess for me,
we
too,
need to make sure people are real and not be
make sure people
machines.
Are real. Make sure that, like I said, I think kids that are at a certain age have no business being on social media.
Well, like a car.
And now the argument is like, well, if they're not on social media, then they don't, you know, then they can't do anything. And it's like, well, then why are they all on social media?
Hey,
so like an age limit? Do you think an age limit, like a drinking age?
A hard age limit. Yeah.
Hard age
and
limit.
Not
what
this,
is the
like,
age limit?
Are
you have to pick one.
Above, so I know right now it's 13.
13's fine. I would make it older.
I'd make it like 16 to,
I would really 16. Want to graduate from high school, ideally. Closer to driving a car.
Yeah, that's what I liked about the initial Facebook was you had to be going to college. Gotcha. So that, to me, says there's at least some adult level of maturity. Yeah. And
if you've made
great
it to college, your damage hasn't, your emotional damage hasn't fully crippled your ability to function in society.
The idea of like middle schoolers, junior high students dealing with all that crap, like, ugh.
Kids have, their brains are still developing. And
kids are monsters.
And I'd say 15-year-olds I taught high school, they are
They're
terrible
animals.
People. They
haven't fully developed their empathy yet.
Exactly.
They're literally sociopaths.
But I was going to say something that I kind of forgot.
But I don't know.
No offense if we get listeners
like,
with kids.
Like,
your kids are
great. What would you do
without
social media? It's like, I had no social media. Just watch TV like normal people.
Well, the whole thing is like in the documentary, the kid like doesn't have his phone. He's like moping around his room for hours, like looking at the ceiling.
Oh, my God.
Like, read a book.
My dad would lose his goddamn
read
mind.
A book.
Like, would be like, there's a lawn that needs to be mowed.
Yeah.
I have chores to do.
Honestly, you guys look like you're upper middle class. You have cable.
Oh, my God. And Lance was like, what would you do if our child broke that container? I was like, first of all, I would take
that's crazy. That's the most unrealistic scene in the entire film.
Yeah. I'm not a corporal punishment person, but.
No. This would be like Lance would be like, what would you do? It's like, I would take that hammer and I would beat the hell out of their phone. If that child had that phone, I would rip the phone out of their hand and just beat it out.
And the parents were just like, oh, well, you know.
I'm upset.
Oh, my God.
These phones are so bad.
Did you guys see that?
Would be rendered chunks.
Yeah, I would.
Of
I would. I would. I would probably destroy my kid's phone.
Yeah.
At some point.
Yeah. So if we were to summarize our Bill of Rights,
some of us knocking out phones. Hand me your phone too.
Yeah,
I'm a vigilante now.
Yeah, I paid for it. Phone. I'm gonna.
Yeah,
yeah,
it is.
If you were to,
and also that kid who had the shattered screen, it was just getting all these paper. I keep imagining him getting
all
these
the
paper
cuts. Oh, I've never. Oh.
Yeah, he's got glass shards in his fingers because he can't help but look at the photos of the
that
girl he crush on.
That's real, actually.
No.
Sorry.
I cannot get myself back to being 16.
No, good.
I wouldn't pay. I wouldn't. You couldn't pay me to go back.
If we were to summarize our Internet Bill of Rights, you got to be 18, 16?
16.
I'm not going to put a number on it because I'm not
age
an expert.
Limit.
I think
an
the
age
first
limit.
Thing
Doctor.
We have to do is. Well, the first
Sorry.
Thing we do is we create
regulatory
don't put
body.
Words in my
I'm
mouth.
Not gonna, you stole $5 from me.
You gave me $5. You stole,
pressure
you stole an hour and 38 minutes from me.
You
track
it?
We exchanged.
Yes, I put it in as billable hours.
It was 98 minutes long.
Okay.
Yeah, you'll see
so
it at the end of the,
it?
You'll see it. Yeah, you'll I built it on firm development. You'll see it in a month. So I think first off there has to be a panel of experts that'll include doctors.
None of them can be
former
tech
employees.
Owners.
Yeah, like I want that lady who
I
works
want the cross section of the public.
What school did that? What the doctor for the addiction
Stanford,
doctor?
But I'm sure.
No, she wasn't Stanford.
Was
she
was NYU.
NYU. Yeah. I want
the
addiction.
Black lady? There's one cool black lady who had the had earrings like tassels. That's all I can remember.
She was cool.
She was
I remember
cool.
her. No,
I saw this movie like a month ago.
But it would
so
have
like,
to be
I'm really trying
yeah.
to
like I don't think we even necessarily need to get like activists that are anti,
we
right?
Need experts.
We just need doctors. We need unbiased experts to say what impact is this having? Like, what is an age where it's not going to be?
I don't
harmful.
Think we've researched it really.
Addiction
yeah.
doctor.
I mean, oh yeah, but as far as the social media part, yeah.
So I think we need to get a panel of experts. I think you have to look at what age are people coming into this, what kind of notifications and systems are we letting them develop to like loop people back in, and then I think you have to regulate what kind of advertisements you're allowed to put in there and how much you can hide it.
Oh yeah, yeah. We've got children's TV, which is totally on point because I read children's TV trying to sell me all this crap.
Right.
I want the sugar smacks.
But this becomes my cross-section of, like, I think political advertising is out of control. So, like, for me, I think social media should have zero
political
ads.
Social media should have no ads.
That brings – social media should have
no
ads.
No political ads.
All political ads. Okay, so that brings me to our next thing, which I want to make a whole little segment here.
Somebody who sends ad money to have lots of legal ads. But that's just true. Only my law firm should have legal
for
ads.
Profit and for-profit enterprises.
Yeah.
Or, you know – I guess it's hard to say, like, well, not-for-profits can't advertise, but, like,
I mean, some of them are doing.
All these PACs just call themselves a not-for-profit.
Oh, that's true.
And blah, blah, blah.
They should go through some sort of approval process where we know they're not
There has to be an approval process.
It's like how many different managers are going to add.
So hold on. Before we
get
into that, let me button this up conversation really quick. Does our previous conversation change when we realize the context that we, as modern estate planning, we do currently use artificial intelligence Facebook ads.
You might actually be watching this video on Facebook.
Because of a Facebook ad, which is the definition
because
of irony.
Because you took 3 seconds looking at a picture of a meme about estate planning instead of 1 second.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Is there a meme about estate? Oh, God. I'm related. I shouldn't
have brought that up.
No, I think that's interesting.
Well,
does that change when you write a will,
No, because for me, a for-profit ad is what it is on its face.
I'm not hiding it. I'm selling estate plans.
Like, we're selling something.
Well, I'm selling you a better life, goddammit.
If they want to try to manipulate me into buying some shoes, fine. That's okay. I just don't like it when it's advertising that's designed to manipulate what you think is going on in the world.
Oh, yeah.
And, trying to manipulate your worldview instead of trying to just sell an item.
I mean, we have a talk show that is pretty much designed to educate people and persuade their worldviews and we're not trying to do it maliciously.
I'm not trying to encourage you to overthrow your government
not telling you how to vote or anything.
If you ask me, I'll tell you how to vote.
Yeah,
but
if you ask me as an individual, I'll talk to you about how I feel politically.
There's only one right way to vote, and that's how I'm doing it.
I'll
tell you.
Okay, let's shift gears to a new here.
Particularly in this battleground state, definitely call me, ask me how to vote.
Yeah, if we keep talking about this, you're going to send me another $5.
Yeah.
Go ahead. Cool. In the context of the 2020 presidential election, do you think people should be able to vote online?
I am a real Luddite when it comes to things like that.
I actually prefer voting in person.
Yeah? What do you mean Luddite? I don't know what that means. I'm an idiot.
It's super fun.
Anti-tech.
It was a sect of people in Central Europe.
I think it was France.
Were they France?
Didn't
Germany,
like technology,
Roman
right?
Empire. They would like go and like just like here's how long ago it was. Okay. They thought that like the printing press was like the devil.
Bad news.
And they would go and like destroy printing presses.
Good stuff.
So now I had a law professor call me a Luddite.
It really undercuts this whole the monastic writing of things manually.
I had a law professor who asked me about like, well, what do you think wire fraud encompasses? I was like, you know, like phones and telegrams. And he's like, telegrams. What are you, a Luddite? And then he moved on.
Holy shit.
So
oh my God, a law professor.
He was great.
That's the best way. Remember, law professor was like, do you think arson is an inherently dangerous crime?
It was on.
And I remember panicking and saying no. And it's like, are you sure? I was like, I don't know. I'm just trying to get
He was great. It was a federal criminal procedure, and he was a former AUSA, and he did like some like super badass stuff. And he would just like tell us his good stories. We'd have like, he's like, all right, so you're setting up a sting in, you know, let's say theoretically South Chicago.
Yes. Yes.
And like, it was awesome.
Oh, I love that.
So to circle back.
Yeah, here we go. Online voting.
It makes
me
uncomfortable because I think anytime you're bringing more technology into something, it makes it more vulnerable.
I agree.
I think voting should have a paper record.
But I also am a person who has an employer who's willing to let me go vote in person.
Have you voted yet?
I have not.
You need to go vote anyway.
I'm not registered in Georgia. I'm registered in New York,
I have to
do my mail-in.
You know we're a swing state.
Well, but just so you know, before you vote, if you want to be reimbursed, you have to talk to Stephen. He'll give you a list.
Yeah, you have to vote for the approved candidate.
Yes.
Now that's illegal, right?
Wait, hold on, that's not illegal.
Hold on a minute. You can offer me a financial incentive to vote.
Well, I
for
cannot pay you to vote.
Okay.
I can pay you for your job.
Can you pay
vote
me
how I like you to vote? No.
Vote how you want.
But I understand. No.
Vote how you want.
What congressional district are you in? Who's your congressman?
I don't know.
I think you might be in a swing congressional district.
In New York?
Yeah, New York. I think your house district might be, you're in upstate, you're like Syracuse?
Yeah.
I think your district might be up for grabs.
Okay.
Anyway. We'll talk about it later.
Okay, we will. I gotta go do it.
I'm not gonna tell you who to vote for.
No.
I feel outed here.
Vote for, I don't really care who you vote for, just vote for somebody.
I'm gonna vote
for
somebody.
I did not vote in a presidential election until 2016.
Okay.
Wow.
Don't worry about outing yourself not voting.
You obviously voted for Trump and Steven.
Obviously, I gotta get this guy on my docket.
Hold on a minute. Let's bring it back to this. Okay.
Yeah.
So online voting, you're a Luddite, you're like, no. Online banking. Do you do online banking?
Yeah, but I think that's different.
Oh.
Yeah. I think it's different.
I think it's different too. Because you got
the thing is, online banks get hacked all the damn time.
That's true.
How often do people get their bank accounts hacked? How often do they expose themselves to a vulnerability for the bank account? And then they have this huge headache to try to undo it. This is a vote. And like,
but then the nature of banking is different than the election, because it's all one collective event on one given day. So it incentivizes.
Yeah. I also don't trust who's going to run it? Like, are they going to subcontract it to the lowest bidder? Are we going to have like adequate servers to handle all the traffic? Like, there are too many things that could go super wrong, and there's nothing that's a hard copy that actually.
And I also cynically, I kind of...
Like, couldn't you make the same argument that, like, okay, like, we can't have an online banking system because, like, who's, like, there's no record, there's no hardcore paper record.
But the thing is, I can go on my bank account online and I can see, okay, how much is in my account?
Yeah.
And if there's an error, I can see what it is and I can contact them to fix it. Whereas with voting, I mean, a lot of states, you know, if you do a mail-in vote and it doesn't go through, they don't have to tell you until after the election.
Georgia does. So go online and look.
That your vote didn't count. So if we're doing mass online voting, like I'm not as worried about like voter fraud, because like if voter fraud is going to happen, it's going to happen. I think, you know, there are ways that you can verify identity for online voting, but I'm more worried about just interference.
Okay.
I like this.
And that's very valid. Like that's why we don't do it.
I mean, personally, I don't do it because I like the the ceremony of voting.
Yeah. Going to the place, waiting in line for 20 million hours.
I waited for
hours.
2 hours.
Yeah, I waited for 2.5 hours.
No, but like that's wild. Like that's a wild, unrealistic expectation for the majority of people.
It is.
It should be a holiday, but it should also be like.
But okay, hold on a minute. We're living in the 21st century where I don't have to wait 10 minutes for my Subway sub to come from my line. And I'm now, because it's voting day, I'm going to go wait in line for 3 hours just to execute my democratic right. And I don't have to. Because I have every option to sit at home for free, but I have to go stand in this 3-hour line.
What's more important, voting or a teriyaki chicken sandwich?
Teriyaki? No, I'm kidding.
Okay, cynically,
tell that to 2012,
like,
James.
Okay, I know everyone should vote. I think we should have compulsory voting.
Sure. Yeah, where you have to pay a fee if you don't. You have to pay a fine.
There should be a fine if you don't vote.
I agree with that.
But
interesting.
You don't agree with that.
Most other countries have. I mean,
people have died. I don't know. I'm in the point where America, man, people have died for our freedom.
Literally, though, my grandfather was born in 1929.
Yeah.
The Voting Rights Act was passed when he was my age, when he was 36 years old.
Yeah.
He waited a long-ass time to vote.
Yeah.
And I feel like I just wait those 2 hours because he would haunt me from his grave if I didn't go vote. But, like...
Yeah, no, that's a great perspective.
Like,
that's a
good point. But minimally, though, like... I don't know. I kind of like the collective community environment. We're all there to try to impact the government. Even if it was a 2-hour line, it's
imagine that line. There,
but there's very few things that we have in America now. We're all on
united.
The same page.
And they have
I get
things,
it.
Though.
I understand that.
Where
if, no, and I get
like,
it. I understand
that. If you're elderly.
The worst people.
Really? Trump supporters? Oh, no, I'm sorry. I mean, we're politically in the middle. Are we trying to
cut that out?
With the note that I'm riding with Biden, but like people are like Trump and Jesus are like, God damn it, I'm gonna stay in line so I can cancel that lady's vote.
Do me a favor.
I will not die.
Imagine that line if there is compulsory voting, right? And every single person like
we should have
like,
better voting systems.
I mean,
we should have more polling places.
Voting should be like banking. There should be like a bank in every corner. We should be able to.
You
vote
should be able to go
quickly.
Vote at the post office.
Yeah.
One of my questions on here. Some people view America's reluctance to adopt online voting as a form of voter suppression, so that only people who vote are predominantly old, rich, white people.
I would.
Do you agree or disagree?
No, because the people who have smartphones tend to be those same people. The people
I feel
have
like,
the technology
I feel like,
to be,
I feel like smartphones are
be,
almost ubiquitous.
Well, now they're ubiquitous, but like the access to technology and stuff like that is
typically leans
more higher education, higher income brackets to who would do it.
So you don't think that more young people would vote if it was online?
I think more young people would vote if they voted. I don't. I think it's
so
a
so you
cop
don't
out
think you
say.
Don't think putting voting online would make more young people vote.
I think there
I
are.
I wouldn't want their votes. Honestly,
really?
Okay. If your vote is merely tied to the slight inconvenience of going out to vote,
if there was a Twitter
how
poll,
how much do you
right
love
now.
Your country? I'm indifferent towards America a lot of time, but on election day, I really give a fuck because it's like if you aren't gonna do the minimum effort of even sending a mail ballot in, okay?
Minimum effort.
Okay.
of a mail-in ballot.
You have to register to vote. I have never bought a stamp in my life.
Oh, no. You don't have to buy a stamp. You just take it to the post office, and then they stamp it for you.
It's easier than that. Okay, in Cherokee County, when I voted absentee for the primary, you fill out the application. I took a picture with my phone and emailed it to the clerk, who then mailed me a ballot. I then had to fill out. And then put back in the mail.
Yeah.
See, I didn't have to mail anything in. It's a mail that last thing. And I didn't acquire that one stamp.
Okay.
It was a very low bar.
So I think
young people don't want to vote for whatever reasons, but you cannot blame technology on it.
We have made, a lot of places in this country have made voting in person difficult on purpose.
Yes.
And I think the solution isn't necessarily to use these methods of voting that are more prone to interference.
Make voting in person easier.
Make voting in person easier, right? So you're talking about like young voters, right? Mm-hmm. So, all right, if you're at high school, right, you turn 18, there's an election year, then make the high school a polling place.
Yes.
And let them vote while they're at school.
They should be able to sign up to vote at school.
Not even sign up, but it should be mandatory.
You're in high school.
This morning we're voting.
You're 18. Here's your voter registration card. Right.
Everything should be closed on election day. And I think if you're an essential business, you have to stay open. I think it should be made that anybody work more than 4 hours.
Other states have a better system.
And I get a lot of people say, well, it's not fair to take away hours from people who need it. But
then pay them.
You know what? Then pay them. Yeah, then pay them.
I mean, some states have primary.
I'd be fine if the government subsidizes.
It's also kind of arbitrary because we have elections on Tuesdays where others. I mean, certain states like Hawaii have their primaries on Saturday, which makes way more sense than a Tuesday. If we're going to have it on a day off, doesn't make it a weekend where people are already off.
Make it easier to vote in person by expanding the number of polling places, by expanding their hours, and by telling people ahead of time whether they're registered or not. It shouldn't be difficult.
It should be very easy. I mean, Georgia is actually fairly good at it.
I got so many things in the mail saying, like, a member of your household is not registered to vote. And we're all registered to vote. And I keep getting
scary stuff. Aren't there two people in your household?
And we're both registered to vote. I mean, unless you're talking about the dog, but she's under 18. She can't vote.
Not yet. I have to wait for a few more years for the dog to vote.
Maybe it's because I'm young, but I do think it's regressive that you cannot vote fully online. I think many more young people would vote if it was online. I think it would be.
I'm an old man.
Also, no offense, Stephen, but offense.
Nonetheless.
I think it would. I think if more young people did vote, it would obviously skew left, I think.
It would, but just makes me upset. If you really believe in leftism or believe in anything minimally, what are you going to do at that hour? You're going to watch another Netflix special? Get off your ass and vote. The country's burning down. When can I convince you? I will come to your house. If you live in Cherokee County or Cobb County, I will come to your house.
You hear that?
I will
drive you TikTok-ing.
Personally. Stop doing your TikTok. Go out and vote.
And Fortnite-ing and go vote.
Pokemon, go to the polls. Yes. I want to die. Oh, my God. Do you remember when Hillary Clinton said that? I wanted to smash my head
against
the
wall. When I voted in Cherokee County, I lived there a couple years ago.
Yeah.
She was like, share it on. Thanks for voting. You should tell your friends. Tell on Twitter. Tell on Twitter. Whatever. I wanted to give her a hug. I love you so much, ballot lady,
told
me to use Twitter for my friends.
You're like, ma'am, that's a curse word.
But she was like a retired lady, but she was really amped about it. And I was like, thank you for not knowing. You don't need to know what young people are thinking, but you should be voting.
Last question.
Vote twice. No, don't vote twice.
Last question.
Vote every year, though.
We wake up tomorrow, okay, and there's a new law instituted by Trump. He signs an executive order, okay? We're gonna make an app, and every time you buy a phone, and it's gonna auto-load on everybody's phone, okay?
This is what you get for not voting. This is what you get when you don't vote. You get people make dumb laws.
Okay. Let's hear the law.
We wake up. Everyone in America who buys a new phone or has a phone has an app on their phone. It's called Poll USA, right?
Uh-huh.
Okay. Every time there's a policy decision, every time there is any political decision that gets made in this country, every single person in the United States has to vote on, am I in favor of this or am I not? And it's not on every single one, but it's on like the majority, right? Like, what are your thoughts? And then it's in layman's terms, right? So that the average person can understand. Yeah. Do you support a system like this or do you disagree?
I think I would agree with it in principle, right? I would love it if it was really, really easy to get super informed and to know what the issues are. Now, the idea of doing it from a phone is interesting because then you've got biometrics, right? So if you could actually attach like a fingerprint to it, And so say your fingerprint's in a database, which all of our fingerprints are in databases. So you could attach to a fingerprint
Your DNA is probably going to be somewhere.
Yeah, that's actually a way to get across around some of the issues I have. But at the same time, I want to know what kind of server are they hosting this? How is it encrypted? Because, you know, when they do this, what they do is they get it to the lowest bidder, right? And you just get these, like, shitty systems that just can't handle it. So if the federal government wants to do this and they're going to take ownership and they're going to say every state has to use our system, right? So you don't have, you know, like a state like New York is going to have an incredible system because they have a lot of money.
Gotcha. So it's not a federal app developer.
Well, I'm not going to. It's a state level.
Gotcha. All right. No, I'm sorry. Is that what you're saying? Is that what you're arguing for?
Often stuff like that winds up being state level, and then some states do a great job, and others do terrible.
It's a federal level.
And they'll do it on purpose.
It's a federal level. We raise a bunch of taxpayer money. It's a great app, and it works perfectly every time.
So what's the point of this? Is that to get their
increase the number of voters coming in?
Well, I feel like the general mentality
is that
Donald Trump lost the popular vote but still won the presidency, right? So I think the general idea is that, like, the majority of America, right, like the Electoral College, right? The Electoral College gives power to states that don't have as many people, right?
Right.
So do you support the idea of, like, a mob-ruled United States where everybody gets a Twitter poll and everybody votes, like, policy?
Still no.
No.
No?
I don't.
Okay. I believe in expertise still.
This is the reason why we have a representative democracy, not a direct democracy.
Right.
And so the Founding Fathers wrote about this in the Federalist Papers. I think it's Federalist 10, I want to say.
I think you're right. I haven't read the Federalist Papers
where they write about
–
they call it faction.
I didn't really understand the Federalist Papers until I saw that movie with Nick Cage where he steals the Declaration of Independence.
When I was in college, my freshman year of college, I read the Federalist Papers twice and Democracy in America three times for different classes.
Yeah, I've read the Federalist Papers. So, but they talk about factions and the danger of mob rule specifically. Yeah. So no, I think if we put that in front of the founding, like, they specifically said, you know, if you do it direct, right? It's too easy for a large group that might not even be, like, the full majority, but, like, a dominant in their locality. It's too easy for them to take too much power and to oppress the minority group. Mm-hmm. And they specifically wanted to try to avoid that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the Founding Fathers were subjective individuals. You, James Champlin,
I agree with that.
You agree with
that? I think mob rule is driven by emotion. I think that extra layer between, you know, the mob that's why I think we should have let me clarify.
Yeah.
I don't have a problem with, like, the president being elected by popular vote.
Okay.
Right. I don't have a problem with, like, senators being elected by popular vote, right? Even, you know, we need to have better districting for our other representatives. Yeah. But, like, I do think that electing somebody to act on our behalf is a very purposeful thing. Because I think even, you know, we've just talked about how technology is destroying the human brain, right? Initially, we did this representative democracy because there wasn't the technology for everybody to say exactly what they want to say. And that adds that level of expertise in addition to that. So now we no longer need that for the technological aspect. We could very easily just do straw polls for everything. But we're still dealing with just emotion. We're not dealing with somebody who, you know, can think about other things that are going on. But we have to have better elected officials before that, you know, really matters.
Yeah, sweet. That's our
Steven, two minutes. No, I'm
kidding. Oh, God. tight.
Don't try and charge me for that.
In the debates, you know, when they're great, Trump, 2 minutes.
I don't think the idea that, like, the American – we have plenty of polling about what the American people think. There's a giant misalignment between what people want and what politicians do, and I don't think it's a data gap. I think it's a democratic gap.
Okay. What do you mean by that? Democratic gap.
So
a failure of the system.
There is a systemic failure, partly because of intensity issues. Like, just because I feel a certain way about, let's say, I don't know, about potholes. Mm-hmm. I feel a certain way about filling them in, but I don't feel that intense about it.
Okay.
It's not going to inform my vote.
I feel pretty intense about it when my alignment of my car goes out.
Yeah.
It's
like a local election. Yeah, exactly.
If there was a politician that just said, I'm going to fill every damn pothole, I might vote for that person.
That was Gretchen Whitmer.
How are you going to pay for it?
Gretchen Whitmer. In Michigan, Gretchen Whitmer, when she was elected governor, she ran like, I'm going to fix the damn roads.
Hilarious.
And that was like, I was driving around and hit potholes, and she won.
I went to a school with a very strong industrial engineering program. So, like, that platform, that resonates with me hard. Oh, yeah. Like,
but once you're with a bunch of data, a bunch of people who aren't that interested in the issue matter, so often there's like a very intense minority on a number of issues that actually does move the political spectrum. And there's like maybe five issues that might get me to actually get off my butt to do something.
Yeah, kind of squeaky wheel issue.
Yeah, exactly. So for some people, like abortion, or like race, or whatever, potholes might not rise. Potholes might be that issue where they'll get up in the morning and they'll be like, I'm going to give $10,000
to the politician. Today I will defeat potholes.
Well, don't drive into Cab Avenue.
Artists do that. They get up and then they do mosaic tiles.
Exactly. But the issue is, but the raw data doesn't capture the intensity which actually moves elections.
Yeah.
How much do you care about shit is the way more of an issue of what do you care about. And also politicians, their incentives are also misaligned because they mostly care about either who will get them reelected or who will give them the most money to get reelected.
So it sounds like you're in favor of this popular vote Twitter poll system.
People won't do anything with the data. It'll just be a bunch of data that marks your position.
Referendum
voting.
If it's a referendum, exactly. Does it replace Congress?
Yes. Let's just say yes. It's command economy or not.
Oh,
economy,
God, we can't do that.
Not command economy. But
okay, I can't.
Mob rule. It would be anarchy.
It would be anarchy, and most people are dumb. And a given issue. I'm a lawyer. I do a state law.
Yeah.
All I know is a state law. I literally got a traffic ticket once, and I went to the courthouse to do my traffic ticket, and then my good friend was there, happened to be there. She does traffic ticket law. I was like, Steven, what are you here? I'm doing traffic ticket. It's like, I'm going to do this for you as a favor.
Yeah.
And she got my ticket thrown out.
Oh, that's
she
nice.
Fixed it.
Well, just think about
it. I came there with my credit card to pay the ticket. Yeah. And she got it fixed. I'm a lawyer with an expert.
I need experts.
On a real issue, getting experts.
No, that makes sense. That actually makes a lot of sense. Okay, so we don't support mob rule. We don't support just popular vote.
Am I yelling?
No. A little bit.
Yeah, a little bit.
It's great. I'm enjoying it.
We have to fix that in post.
I think if anything.
We can't do dumb people. We can't have people who don't know what they're doing making
voting
decisions.
We already have
enough in Congress who don't know what they're doing, so we should try to mitigate that. But I do think we should be polling the public more, and politicians should be acting in accordance with it.
Yeah, definitely. Now that we have the technology to do it.
And I think that we should have official polls that are created by bipartisan groups, because like too many polls where it's like, how do you think the president's doing? Great, awesome, wonderful, pretty good. There's no bad answers.
I do conceptually like your idea, but it should not be going to government.
By the way, this is not my idea. I'm not pushing for this. I think it's a terrible idea. I just thought it was a fun experience.
Look at you, moderator.
Let's just say there's like Google polling whatever that doesn't gather data on what Americans were thinking on day-to-day issues.
Right. Well, look, if you need one that big, you have to use SurveyMonkey.
That's true.
Yeah, Survey.
This podcast brought to you by SurveyMonkey. Anyway, with that,
where's my check?
That brings us to the end of this episode of Let's Talk About Death and Taxes. Guys, thanks so much for watching. If you enjoyed this, let us know. Guys, our law firm is dedicated to making wills and trusts and helping people with end-of-life legacy preservation. Because of that, we've created a PDF, a downloadable PDF that is basically an intro to everything that you need to know about estate planning. Basically, the process of making sure that everybody gets what you want after you pass away. You can go ahead and download that link in the description to get that PDF. Basically, you will learn everything that you need to know to create a great estate plan. Guys, thanks so much for watching. By the way, if you would like to work with us, you can give us a call at 404-939-7562 or send us an email at info@modernestateplanning.com. Also, if you could share this on your timeline, that would really, really help us out. Guys, have a great day. Thanks so much for watching.